A very good evening to all. On behalf of Cambridge University Press, I welcome you all to today's event and thank you very much for your participation. Cambridge University Press is a division of University of Cambridge, and it constitutionally it is devoted to printing and publishing for the acquisition, advancement, conservation and dissemination of the knowledge in all the subjects. It delivers a core component of the university's mission of advancing worldwide research and learnings at the highest scholarly levels and stimulate debates and discussions in the significant topics. We are here today to discuss Anuj Bhuwania's Quoting the People, Public Interest Litigation in Post-Emergency India. The book studies the politics of PIL in contemporary India. PIL is a unique jurisdiction initiated by the Indian Supreme Court in the aftermath of the emergency of 1975-1977. The book shows how PIL grants the appellate courts flexibility in procedure, allowing them positions of supreme authority. Anuj teaches in Department of Sociology at South Asian University, New Delhi. He has held visiting faculty positions at the Center for Modern Indian Studies, University of Göttingen, the Center for the Study of Developing Societies, New Delhi, and the Center for the Study of Law and Governance in Jawaharlal Nehru University. So we hereby welcome our panelists, Anup, Surendranath, Rohit, Nivedita, Menon, Shomona, Khanna, our author, Anuj Bhuwania, and Pratiksha, who will chair the session this evening. I now request the speakers to take this stage and open the discussion for the evening. Thank you very much.
Print on all our work and our activism. And since he has had a formal introduction, all I wanted to say is that conversations with Anuj have always sparkled due to not only his voracious reading, but also the fact that he brought history together with anthropology, which I think you imbibed at Columbia, and your skepticism of populism, perhaps in spite or because of your education at the National Law School in Bangalore. So I give to you Anuj Bhuwania, who will make a few opening remarks about how he lost his way and ended up in the court. And as any legal ethnographer will confess, such research often entails dealing with a fair amount of heartbreak and an equal amount of boredom in the courtroom. Anuj.
Thank you, Pratiksha. Thank you all for coming. Thank you, Cambridge University Press, for organizing this event so well. I'm particularly happy that Pratiksha is chairing this session because she's, as she says, she has been a part of the process, you know, she's been part of the journey which has culminated in this book. You know, teaching with her was an educating experience for myself, as well as, you know, her initiative of LastNet, Law in Switzerland's network, was the first time I ever presented any work which happened to be about this work, actually. It was the first time I presented at LastNet, and since then I've presented in two other editions. In fact, the book was first discussed last month at another edition of the fourth edition of the conference in Habitat Center in December. So thank you, Pratiksha, for being there. And thank you, all four of our panelists here. All four of you have been people whose work I've admired for a long time, and I'm particularly happy that, you know, you agreed and have been willing to be subjected to this. I look forward to your comments. So the discussion today is, of course, structured around their reactions, their comments, but you know, that is the main course for the evening, really. But I thought we thought that it might be useful to begin with a small starter with my kind of small introduction to the book, because the book is obviously very, very new and very few of you would have had a chance to look at it. So it would be, we thought, useful to just briefly introduce not really the arguments of the book or the you know what the but just to kind of give a flavor what the book is about. So so I will just try to you know, speak for a few minutes to introduce the book. So PIL, as we call it, public interest litigation, PIL has been central to how we think of the Indian judiciary and its politics over the last three, four decades. It has long been a metonym for the greatness of the Indian judiciary. There has been a broad consensus around the way we think about PIL. that it started with noble motives, or slightly more cynically, as an attempt to exorcise the demons of the Supreme Court's performance during the emergency. That PIL started out being pro-poor, that's how we understand it, that it started out being pro-poor, and that it still sometimes is, but thanks to neoliberalism and the concomitant change in economic environment, it has become increasingly anti-poor. The broad argument of this consensus is that PIL was mostly progressive in the 20th century, but in the 21st century it has become increasingly regressive. This book tries to undo this consensus around PIL. Now, before I try to go to what this book tries to do rather than not tries not to do, I just want to say that this I myself was a believer in this kind of theory of PIL, this kind of understanding of PIL. Before I started my research on this project around 10 years back now, actually, 8 years back, I too, had subscribed to a view which I just described. I went to law school in the late 1990s when PIL was considered, one of the great contributions, in judiciary along with perhaps the basic structure doctrine. And this view started unraveling to some extent. This glorious view, that is, started unraveling to some extent by the end of 20th century, perhaps marked in particular by the Narmada Bachao Andolan case, where the Supreme Court gave a verdict to allow for the construction and of the dam. And it disappointed many of us, but we still did not, see. It continued to be what I call the ideological critique of PIL continued. That was the idea. The two broad strands of criticism that arose from that time was that it was increasingly anti-poor, the PIL, and that there was this discourse of judicial overreach. Now, both of these two very, very, almost commonsensical views of PIL, I try to argue, in fact, conceal more than they reveal these particular ways of thinking about PIL. Between the early part of the 21st century, I was actually a student again, I started out being a law student, then I studied anthropology. I was in the U.S. and occasionally I would hear about some of the great achievements of PIL, like not allowing cycle rickshaws in Chandni Chowk and some more absurd such achievements. It would seem like it would seem like a classic, kind of example of middle class bias or anti-poor bias, etc. That kind of view, one could easily subscribe to it. But when I started doing this work, which actually happened serendipitously, it really began with following up on one particular demolition notice of one particular slum. This particular notice listed a writ petition under which his demolition had been ordered, but none of the inhabitants of that settlement had ever heard of this case. I started helping the legal response to this action, but understanding and legally responding to this order required us to follow this particularly monstrous case called the Kalyan Sanstha case, one of the great slum demolition case, probably the biggest of them all that we saw in this period, around between 2005 and 2008, it was quite active. So understanding the enormity and the bizarreness of this case led me to start following a series of cases relating to slum demolitions in Delhi. For the first 1 year of my research, my focus was purely on PIL cases related to demolitions. But gradually I realized that court-led slum demolitions had to be studied in the context of other PILs, particularly those related to urban governance. Thereafter, my fieldwork was aimed at understanding PIL per se by studying the practices around it. My research involved participant observation in various PIL courts, and I would, besides, of course, being present in the appellate courts, especially during days where there would be more of these PIL cases being heard, I interviewed a lot of lawyers, etc. But anyway, just to say that what I feel that this provided me a kind of an empirical vantage point to look at PIL, which I feel that this naturally led to the ideological view of PIL somehow breaking down in front of me. I mean, looking at PIL in its materiality, which an empirical approach required, led me to see that the problem with PIL was much bigger than just being anti-poor or judicial overreach. In fact, perhaps these attributes could be present in other judiciaries, but all of them get incredibly exacerbated by the presence of something called PIL, which, as we will see. So what does the book try to do? This book is aimed at addressing the politics of PIL per se. Because PIL is primarily a revolution in judicial procedure, the focus is on the transformation in the nature of adjudication itself that PIL enables. Instead of focusing on specific areas of substantive legal doctrine enunciated in PIL cases, the attempt here has been to think through the quotidian realities of the PIL process. I argue that the fundamental nature of PIL is to be understood in terms of its protean nature, that its departures from basic legal procedure make possible, rather than in terms of the themes it addresses, whether it be environment, gender, or urban affairs. The instances of PIL that have been taken for critical study here are, therefore, meant to illustrate the kinds of powers that PIL confers to appellate judges. The fact that there are many PIL judges who do not necessarily take the liberties that the judges in the cases I discussed do does not take away from the fact that PIL jurisdiction empowers them to do so. And this is a point that I want to emphasize. It will probably come up in discussion. These cases illustrate the extreme extent to which PIL enables judges to go. The emphasis here is not so much on the unjust outcomes of these processes, rather it is on the profound injustice of the judicial process adapted in them. Not to deny that the outcomes are also quite unjust, but it's the process itself which my focus here is. So oddly, to move from outcomes to process, this is what I'm trying to do. And just to end on a provocative note, PIL, I try to argue in this book, has often been talked of as a romance, if anything as a romance gone wrong. In this book, I will argue that PIL was a tragedy to begin with and has over time become a dangerous farce.
Is a fascinating legal historian at the Department of History at Yale University, and we're looking very much forward to your book, which you describe as constitutional law from below.
Yeah. Came across while looking at the book was the realization that the early debates over setting up Supreme Court of India was based on the idea of a court that one could control. For the longest time, the primary seat of appellate authority was the Privy Council in London, and Indian nationalists from the 1920s onwards wanted the court to be based in Delhi, a court they could see that would be transparent to them and that they could have some degree of control over. And this went into part of the debates around the framework of the Constitution, had this discussion in there. And ironically, the court they created was not one that they could really control. I'm going to confine my remarks to three sets of questions. First, I want to really pick up on the kind of normative account of post-emergency court that Anuj presents, and maybe push to theorizing it a little bit more. And I then want to sort of mark out two territories that Anuj's book sort of sets out for further exploration. One about the empirics and the other bit about understanding the judicial process in general. So as Anuj's, the popular narrative about PIL that we often heard about is the Indian Supreme Court failed in its duty during the emergency. They were scarred with ADM Jabalpur, and a major sort of act of sort of reclaiming legitimacy, restoring authority was through the embrace given to PIL as an idea. And it's interesting that many of the judges who were in the majority in ADM Jabalpur became the exponents in the post-PIL period. And Anuj, I think very importantly, shows us that many of the distinctions one makes between, say, good PILs or bad PILs, or the PILs of the 1980s, which is supposed to be pro-poor, and the PILs of the late 90s, which is supposed to be neoliberal, are actually based on a simple consequentialist reading of the decision. So if we like the judgment, then we say, oh, this was a good PIL. If we don't like the judgment, then we say this is a bad PIL or a bad judge or a bad ideology. What Anuj does is really force us to think about what does PIL itself do as a process, which is basically it removes all kinds of processual guarantees and requirements to allow the judge to implement his will or her will to secure a certain kind of social goal. One would actually read this, in fact, I think it's there throughout the book. The provocation isn't that the PIL is a response to the emergency. The book seems to almost suggest that PIL is the emergency. So if you think about what happens when the emergency officially ends in 1979, on one hand, a lot of, if you think of the emergency really as where is it coming from? It's coming from Mrs. Gandhi's, the Congress's sort of frustration of acting through a series of legal channels to achieve a kind of political, deliver the kind of political goods it wants to deliver. It can't achieve bank nationalization through sort of normal means. It can't, check dissent through normal means. So it requires special procedures. So post the emergency, while officially there is no emergency in the country, emergencies get regularized into a variety of laws. So if you look at when the AFSPA comes up or when the terrorists, when the TADA comes up, these are all post-emergency legislation which retain certain aspects of the emergency. The second aspect of the emergency was really, the entire rhetoric is never to save Mrs. Gandhi's political constituency. The rhetoric is about delivering certain kinds of social welfare and economic welfare. It's about planting trees, it's about removing bonded labor, it's about creating equality between men and women. And all of these are sort of goals that are echoed by the judges of the court in many of the early PIL cases. And the idea really is, again, that ordinary procedures will not let us solve this. We have to solve this through these emergency powers. So there isn't that much of a contradiction between PIL-1 and PIL-2. It very much is about a certain kind of executive authority, which is able to exercise its will by removing a variety of procedural safeguards. So I think this is a case that Anuj makes, he makes it with evidence going through over at least 20 years of jurisprudence of the court and taking down all kinds of other rebuttals very deftly throughout. The second aspect really is that PILs have often been put forward, even by its very authors, as an entirely judge-centric story. Kapila Hingorani, who passed away recently, a Supreme Court advocate, famously complained that she was the first person who brought a PIL case to court in the Hussain Ara Khatun case. But PIL stopped being sort of her baby and became the judge's baby. So the judiciary seizes authorship of what that event is. If we think of PIL cases here, and maybe Anuj will speak about this a little bit later on, and this definitely requires many more researchers looking at it, is not just a judicial process. So while the judge's version is often sort of the most definitive loud voice, there are varieties of steps that take place. And you see some of the actors in the book itself. So there's the, once an order is given out, there's a local municipality guy who has to carry out the demolition order. There's someone at the office who first receives it and translates it. There are all the various functionaries inside court which will convert sort of rhetorical high-flown order into a specific order. There's a small economy of lawyers who are engaging in a variety of PIL work, both for or against the government. There's a large media industry which is extensively interested in PIL. So how do we take into account these variety of, who are the other players in the PIL story? To what extent are they able to sort of either act as breakers or as mediators in this sort of judicial voice that's coming out from top of the court? How do we better understand the process by looking at this set of players? The third issue is that to what extent does PIL help us understand the pathology of the Indian legal system, and to what extent is it sort of confuses us? PILs, despite the disproportionate attention they get in the media and the disproportionate amount of writing on it, forms a very small part of the judicial docket. The statistics I could see, Supreme Court's less than 2% of the cases deal with PILs. So the question really is the kind of critique that we see, that we do make of PILs, the lack of process being followed by the court, the disregard of sort of former jurisprudence, the lack of reasoning, and to some extent the contempt for the petitioner, are these unique to PIL cases, or is it common to a variety of decisions of the court across the board in other fields? Do we see this operating in more routine sorts of cases as well? And again, some of the examples that Anuj points out, this seems to cut across. So famously, something like the Ayodhya judgment, it's not a public interest litigation case. It's a case, it's a property dispute, which involves a question of public interest, but it's not a PIL by itself. But the kind of decision that arrived at, the kind of mechanics of the decision seems to be very similar to that of the PIL case. So perhaps when we're thinking about chronological change, is the difference then that has the PIL bug sort of infected the entire system, or has there been something larger systemically happening of which PIL is one kind of manifestation? And my final point, and I think this is, there's a quote by Colin Gonzalez in here where he says that, you know, you recognize this is a power to do great good or to do great evil, but he'd rather that the court have the power than not have the power. And I think the question that a lot of people who are interested in engaging with the law progressively would want to know, how do if given this sort of, you know, powerful pushback and warning about the PIL, where should one focus resources and focus energies? Thank you.
I now invite Nivedita Menon, professor at the Center for Comparative Politics and
Political Theory, JNU. Nivedita at this moment is experiencing encountering procedure, especially the jurisprudence of show cause notices.
So as I was telling Anuj, as I was ODing on those brilliant pakoras outside, I warned him that I have a bone to pick with him, and I think he could not but have expected it, because the key argument of the book makes a strong case for modern legal rationality, and Anuj knows enough about my work to know that modern legal rationality and I are not exactly on good terms. We're not even a romance turned sour. We're like a stalker whom I have avoided, and you know, it's like on the verge of acid throwing. Given he knows that very well, so given that, I think he would be prepared for a little bit of acid throwing. Anuj's book is a refreshing revisionist reading of PIL. It's a refreshing revisionist reading of PIL in which the generally prevalent understanding that there was once a good PIL in the 1980s that turned into a bad PIL in the 1990s is overturned. Anuj argues rather that there's a sort of sinister continuity in the procedural aspects of PIL that we miss if we focus on the outcomes. What he calls his anti-PIL critique is that PIL is a diminution of judicial process. And his effort is to move this critique away, as he said just now, from outcomes to processes. How is it a diminution of judicial process? Because he argues, and this is largely his words, how it is a diminution of judicial process is because one of the key attributes of the modern judicial process is that it results in a written order that has to be logically consistent. But in PIL reasoning, as explicated by the good PIL judges, Bhagwati, the analysis of a judgment was to be conducted primarily in terms of its social impact, not the structure and soundness of legal arguments. The result, says Anuj, was a deliberate departure from what he sees as the fundamental principles of modern law characterized by logically formal rationality. What PIL provides, in his opinion, is a whole new mechanism to concentrate policy-making power in the hands of judges, enabling them to forge powerful tools to operationalize these new policies. Anuj places the practice of PIL, so by the end of the book, he places the practice of PIL in the realm of legal informalism, he says has infected every part of the Indian legal system. When you start by talking about romance and you end by talking about infection, it's an interesting book, read it. Rajiv Dhawan's term, panchayati justice, is used by him to refer to this informalism, which he sees as manifested in a range of other developments, the Ayodhya judgment, the Bhopal verdict, the emergence of family courts, and so on. The last chapter thus puts all these developments in the space of what he calls the romance of indigenous justice and populism, which he does not like. Now, with Anuj, that there are not two phases in PIL. PIL history, and clearly this is a very fascinating revisionist reading. You could already see from his own and what it said. And I'm completely in agreement.
Surendranath teaches at constitutional law at NLUD, and he's also the director of the Center on the Death Penalty, which comprises the death penalty litigation clinic as well as the project, which produces fantastic report and also provided us a very essential reading material when we were all protesting in JNU in February. Thank you for that, Anup.
Thank you so much, Pratiksha. Thank you, Anuj, for a wonderful, wonderful and provocative book. It was really a pleasure to read it. As a legal academic, I found the book fascinating at three levels before I sort of move more into my substantive comments on it. I think it was really heartening to see a critique of the court's practices moving away from judgments. And I found that it was very well done in the book in terms of relying on the countless orders that courts pass and how the dispensation of justice is not really what we see at the final judgment stage, that it really, much of it is in its dailiness of those orders which are so unreasoned, and there are hardly any, there's anything to judge those reasons by in terms of legal critique, so that was really fascinating to see. And I thought the book gives us some tools to escape the trap that legal academics often fall into in terms of looking for this meta-narrative of the Supreme Court or of what the court is trying to do. And it gives us those tools to understand how we can explain the court's performance on PILs without falling into that trap of saying the court has been anti-poor or was pro-poor in certain times. And it gives us the tools to understand what is at play, really. And also, I think the book does a great job of placing the High Court at the very center of the argument that's being made, and again moves away from, I think for far too long, legal scholarship has focused too much on the Supreme Court without really looking at what it has done to courts below and how courts below are lapping up, or how they're using, and in our own work we see that on the death penalty, of what the court's positions are, how that gets translated and consumed by courts below. So it was really good to see these three things, and thank you so much for that. In terms of the narrative of the PIL, in terms of the classic opening up the doors of justice to people who were until then denied access to justice, what Baxi called juridical middle persons, that justice became, the access to justice became negotiated through these juridical middle persons. And it's good to see what has become of those juridical middle persons in the book, to say that how Anuj shows convincingly that how the middle persons have become the ones accessing this jurisdiction. And in that sense, there's very little that the petitioners or the people for whom this innovation, if you want to call it, was meant to be, have just been excluded from the process entirely, and because so much of it has come to rely on the amicus and the role of the amicus in these proceedings. And I think it questions very nicely the argument that the real check or the real critique or the only way to question what the court is doing with PIL is to judge it on some broad spectrum of what has been referred to Bhagwati as social activism. Whether that those goals of constitutional transformation or social transformation are being achieved by what the court is doing with PIL. And I think it gives us, the book gives us a framework to check what the court is doing through a very different lens. And I think it's very interesting to see that Anuj's arguments are very procedural in nature, and then he calls it that the procedural is political. And in terms of saying that many of the procedural innovations, what were called as innovations in the good PILs,
what you consider as in terms of good PILs only because of the outcomes that you liked in those cases, how those have worked against the petitioners or causes in bad PILs. And I thought it would be very interesting to see how many of these would play out, what this critique might look like in a good PIL case, right? And I was thinking in terms of if you were to apply the framework that you've developed for a right to food case or a right to education case or let's say the manual scavenging case, which I'm sure Shomona will refer to, right? How does this framework play out in that? And then I think, especially in, let's say, the right to education case, it's interesting to think about its history at this moment in terms of how it came through Mohini Jain and Unnikrishnan, how those are terrible cases in which to lay down what the right to education meant. I mean, those cases were about admissions to higher education institutions, the court was looking at capitation fee, and in those, to set the contours of a fundamental right to education and a fundamental right to primary education, I'm sure there was, as you say, there was no real information before the court in terms of how that might be done, or what is it that should constitute the content of this right that the court was developing. So I think in certain case, I really would, and I hope there will be writing on this, picking up on this and saying, okay, let's look at the good PILs. And I think the case that Anuj convincingly makes is to say that it is not to, that it's a false choice, that we have to accept these procedural dilution and this complete procedural dilution, or we just have to throw away the PIL. And I think it's about trying to achieve the very ends of the good PIL through a far more procedurally rigorous manner. It is not about either we have PIL or we don't have PIL, and that's certainly not the argument of the book. And I think we really need to think about the whether we judge too much of what the court does or what the Supreme Court does through the lens of consequences. And I think that's true not just in PIL, I think it's true in much of constitutional adjudication. And I think a classic example for that when I was the Nas case, right? I mean, and I'm referring to the Delhi High Court judgment, right? Of course, the outcome was fantastic, I think, but there was so little critique of how Justice Shah and Muralidhar use the strict scrutiny test, right? How they invoke Anuj Garg and try to read it with Ashok Kumar Thakur, and in this really complicated sense say that, you know, we really need to start applying strict scrutiny, right? And I think, yes, you might argue that there's a case to be made or not, there's not a case to be made, but clearly it's one of the weakest parts of that judgment, right? It's sending, and I think acceptance of that argument, right? The celebration or the unquestioned celebration from that in that sense is just sending a message that clearly that was not the law, right? Because in Ashok Kumar Thakur, the court is very clear, explicitly clear, that you will not apply the strict scrutiny test. Right? And then I think you will see the impact of all of this, and then come back to the burden of the arguments that you make on evidence. And if I may just tie it back to this in terms of that what sort of information should the court base itself on? There seems to be very little information. But I think if you were to focus slightly on the reservation cases, that the politics of evidence, how courts use the burden of evidence, the onus of evidence, on whom do you put that onus? And what is the kind of onus you put, right? That is used, if you look at the reservation cases, as especially in the high courts in the Muslim reservation question, or in the reservations and promotions question, the kind of detail and intensity of evidence that the court requires is impossible to meet, right? And it is one of those rare situations where the court is so empirical, right? It goes into questions of methodology, it goes into sample size, right? And so therefore, I think there's a need to slightly worry about how we place emphasis on this evidence that you need to show us evidence. Who is to show us evidence? Like, I'm sure, like, if Shomona is going to talk about the manual scavenging case, to ask the Safai Karmchari Andolan to what sort of evidence should it place, right? If you were to take that too far down the road, it then becomes a tool in the hands of the court to restrict what it wants to do, and then you might end up facing the same problem. And I think in terms of the manner of adjudication that you talk about, that it resembles panchayati justice. And I think apart from the procedural issues that you raise, I think there's a need to ponder about the doctrinal difficulties that the court has created for itself, in the terms of especially how it understands Article 21, right? And I think much of this goes in terms of the content that is being ascribed to Article 21. And there I would say that there's great conceptual confusion in terms of how the court has not, a court would treat the right to sleep in the same way as, let's say, questions of detention, right? The court's mechanism of how it balances rights is extremely problematic, right? And I think there is that transfer from the PIL, you can see that borrowing from that PIL mode of giving daily orders without not really giving any justification into substantive decisions on fundamental rights, right? And you can see that when the court is pushed on TADA, POTA, AFSPA, you can see that its framework of justification is very much in the realm of not having developed the sufficient tools or the normative framework to identify what are the competing interests, right? Or what is the content of Article 21? And I think there's a lot. And I think it might be institutionally a convenient thing that you don't, in that sense, say how you will balance away, let's say, a detention-related right versus how you might balance a right to access roads, for example, right? Or the right to access to roads in hilly areas. Right, whether the court has the necessary instruments to do that balancing. And lastly, I'd like to finish with a discussion on the creeping role of directive principles of state policy, which get invoked very often, and now fundamental duties. I mean, not now, when I say now, right? Now, I think both of these, I think there is this really disturbing trend, A, that what is being held to be true of the DPSPs are being held to be true of fundamental duties, right? And then I think that has not happened. And I think that is largely to do with the way we have understood the relationship of the directive principles of state policy to fundamental rights. And I think I for one don't agree that the restrictions on fundamental rights are sort of, I think the content of the rights are getting defined by the DPSP. Right, and I think it's almost like that the DPSPs are not just acceptable goals, right? That it's as though you can pretty much do anything to achieve them, right? And in terms of, let's say, and the beef question and anti-cow slaughter legislations are a good example of that, I would think, in terms of, I think there's not enough discussion between pursuing the goal in the DPSP versus that should that really have an impact on the manner in which what you do with Part 3 and the fundamental rights to achieve those goals. And I think it's a much clearer position to say that that the DPSP should not cannot give content to the restrictions envisaged in Part 3. I think there's been a lot of confusion in the courts as to what role these DPSCs must play, and I think you see a sort of progression of that into the National Anthem case as well. So I'll stop with that, and then I'm sure we have time for comments. Thank you.
Shomona is next. Shomona, as we know, is a practicing lawyer in the Supreme Court of India and the Delhi High Court since 1993, and has worked on a variety of human rights issues, including cases which have involved encounter killings, prison reform, two women's rights manual scavengers, and environmental issues, especially her work on forest dwellers and forest law. Thank you for your solidarity with all your sexual harassment work, which we go back to the 90s. So I was wondering how you would read Anuj's book from the point of view of our experience of Vishakha.
Thank you so much, Pratiksha. Thank you, Anuj, for inviting me here. As Pratiksha has said, I'm a lawyer, practitioner, and I'm not an academic, so I will speak experientially. Reading Anuj's book has been both easy and difficult at the same time. It's easy reading because it's really a page turner. I would encourage you to read it. It covers cases and subjects which I had sort of partial information about. Friends had been handling those matters, and I was just found myself eager to know more. But it's also been difficult because it compels me to do some serious soul searching of my own. Many people who've been part of this sort of PIL construction are friends of mine. And in fact, I was recently at the Kapila and Nirmal Hingorani Memorial Lecture, and I was thinking about your book and some of the cases I've been involved in as a youngster and in later years as well. It's also a brave book. It says many things that many of us practitioners have felt and thought and spoken of in safe places, but it takes a certain gumption to take on all the stalwarts of PIL and subject each of them to scathing scrutiny. The book, while focused on two specific cases from the Supreme Court and the Delhi High Court, also mentions several other PILs which have been ongoing in the same period, some of which I've been involved in myself. So what I thought I would do, I hadn't thought of talking about the Safai Karamchari Andolan case, but if I have a little time, maybe I can touch upon that. I was thinking of speaking about some of the thoughts that flowed through my mind with regard to the forest case, or the Godavarman case, which Anuj also mentions in his book. Now, very similar to what the cases that Anuj describes, the forest case began with a simple letter from an erstwhile landlord who was disturbed by the rampant deforestation taking place in forests which had belonged to his family previously and based in Gudalur. Now, this letter was converted into a writ petition as far back as in 1995 and has since been pending. It's probably exploded into one of the largest continuing mandamuses ever seen in this country. And the expansion of issues, again covered by Anuj's book, with relation to the demolition cases, the same kind of thing happened with the forest case, to include forests all over the country, to include things like sawmill licenses, to include things like temporary working permits, which was for mining leases, which was a notion that the court itself invented. And then the creation of a special body called the Central Empowered Committee through a court-approved notification which was issued by the executive. The appointment of an all-powerful amicus curiae, and then of course I think around 7 or 8 amicus curiae to assist the main amicus curiae. The issue of directions and orders and investigations without reference to existing law and or procedure. All these processes took place in the forest case, just as Anuj describes in his book. Indeed, even the orders passed by the court were in the nature of interim orders, unsupported by any reasoning and unreported in the usual law journals, yet carrying the force of law. Some of you are familiar with the story of how I got drawn into this case. Forgive me for repeating myself. But so it was an interesting situation. Sometime in 2002, there were these massive eviction drives that started off in the forest areas of tribals and forest dwellers. When they asked that what's going on, and these are very brutal evictions with elephants and burning of houses and crops. And when they asked what is happening, so they said this is a Supreme Court order. So somebody from the movement contacted me. I had no idea about this forest case, and I went in sort of with a lot of investigative work. I went and found the order, and there's no such order for eviction. It said stay of regularization is different, no? So at that point of time, cutting a long story short, the movement gave me what is known as a watching brief. And I think I spent a lot of time watching the forest matter. And some of you are here who watched the matter with me and helped me on the days that I couldn't be there. Anuj also helped with some of those watching hearings. And so many lawyers have participated in this process. And the purpose of the monitoring was to ensure that the kind of debacle that happened in 2002 with this sudden evictions that happened on the ground will not happen again. But what we also found was that there was this rich and valuable spectacle playing out every Monday and Friday afternoon over a two-hour hearing. And it was, you know, because eviction issue or the issue relating to forest dwellers wasn't really coming up that often, but we were determined to be there for every hearing. But what we found was that there was a lot of stuff going on in those hearings, which was really interesting in terms of how the court has started looking at PIL, and it kind of really forced me to reconsider my sort of youthful views on PIL and what is the my role as a lawyer in the courts. So far from ensuring due process to the concerned parties, the hearings were so completely mystified that very often the amicus, the bench, the representative of the central empowered committee and the court master were the only people who could make out what was going on. The cases listed on a particular day were tabulated by the amicus, and he would very consciously make 5 copies of that list. So nobody else could get a copy of that list, and even the people who were the lawyers who were representing parties in those cases often didn't know what was going on. And the order that was produced at the end of the day, similar to the orders that Anuj describes, they were just, they were supposedly placed in the public domain on the court website. So you could go and download it, but it was an incomprehensible jumble of numbers and jargon. So the affected parties simply remained confused. And of course, tribals and forest dwellers were nowhere in the picture. So my job as a watching brief lawyer was to demystify what is happening and alert my client in the event something affecting tribals and forest dwellers occurred. So I realized pretty soon that the threat was not so much from orders of eviction in that case, but from a lot of the orders which were talking about completely reimagining forests in India in terms of diverting forests for non-forest purpose, what kind of governance is going on, completely rewriting a lot of the law. And there was these shifts taking place in the jurisprudence of forest law and its implementation. So I'll just give you one example which occurred to me, which I thought was very potent, is relating to this whole issue of the net present value. So sometime in 2003, the court had converted the recommendations of the CEC into directions diverting. So they said this net present value of 5 to 9 lakhs has to be paid whenever forest is diverted. Now this was again a number they pulled out of their hat. There was no scientific rationale for this. And over the years, large number of, it was like in thousands of crores of rupees was being collected, managed in an ad hoc fund. So they came up with this idea, and the court actually supervised again the drafting of guidelines. The guidelines were issued by the executive, but the drafting took place inside the courtroom. It was a really interesting exercise to see. So this whole jumbling of the roles of the judiciary and the executive and the legislature happening inside the court. So, anyway, this compensatory afforestation fund was set up. The state government started fighting about getting their money. And this was actually the first time that I saw the court set up a team of what I would consider scientific experts to look into this issue. They had three senior economists from the Institute of Economic Growth, headed by Dr. Kanchan Chopra, to look into this whole issue of net present value. They produced a substantial report which was supported by a lot of interviews, a lot of data collection, a lot of economic analysis, and they gave two key suggestions. I won't get into details, but basically they said this 5 to 9 lakh figure has to be dumped, and you have to have a case-by-case basis analysis, and they suggested a mathematical formula for it. It was basically you just had to fill in the numbers and that was it. The second thing they said was that the amount that is collected should be distributed between the local communities, the state and the center in a decreasing scale. So reducing the control, the size of the share of the center and increasing the size of the share, or actually giving the share to the Gram Panchayats for the first time. This report was completely given the cold shoulder by the court. In fact, I was there in court the day these three economists, senior economists from IEG came to court. They'd been summoned. They sat there through the entire hearing, and the court just ignored them. And at the end of the hearing, they just left. And I remember passing them and they said, why did they call us here if they weren't even going to ask us anything? And then they were just not given any explanation. The CEC submitted a 5-page report. Most of it was a chart, and the court accepted that report, and the NPV has been calculated now again on the basis of that back of the envelope method. So my point being that, this is the kind of thing that occurred to me while reading, is that even when the court has the opportunity, most of the time they don't want experts to come. They don't want to take advice from anybody who knows something about a technical subject or is a domain expert. But even when they do come, they treat them really badly. So I'm not surprised people don't want to help the court. Now the result of these two processes, which is one is that there is no representation from the local communities or the affected parties, and the fact that the court doesn't want to take any advice from technical experts, is that the level of discussion and debate has plummeted to unbelievable depths. Now, I know this, you people will start laughing again, but as a lawyer watching, and I'm sure that Jawahar will sympathize with me, we had to sit through court while people actually said things like this and accepted it. For instance, they passed a sweeping order saying tendupatta collection cannot take place because the forest dwellers burn the forest floor before collecting tendupatta. I mean, what rubbish. Then they said we cleared the Vedanta project because we found tribals were eating grass. I mean, really. In another situation, I remember there was this huge argument, but eventually everybody agreed that underground mining doesn't require forest clearance because you're not harming the trees, you're only... And they accept this and they go on and they pass orders. I mean, it's horrible. So there were times when I would really complain to my client and say, when am I going to go from watching brief into an arguing brief so that I can throw something at these people? When local communities tried to present the complete picture before the court, they have been silenced through different methods. It's not as if people haven't tried. Similar to, the fact that, lawyers are shouted down or they're not allowed to speak or they can't sometimes even get into the courts in the high court matter. It's so crowded. But there's one instance which I thought was particularly poignant, which was a case related to a large multinational Lafarge in Meghalaya, where the proceedings were going really well and it looked like the petitioners were being able to, really move the court. The court was actually really angry about after looking at a lot of the evidence they had put. very solid evidence of wrongdoing on the part of the company, on the part of the financials of the company, on the part of the state administration, central administration. And then somebody file an application saying that these people are doing illegal mining. And these were tribals, and they have customary rights to do a certain amount of mining. So before they could even place that argument before the court just said that you people are doing illegal mining, we don't have to listen to you anymore. This case is delinked from your case. They pronounced a judgment, and then the issue relating to illegal mining by the petitioners was left in the air. They had to kind of defend themselves, and nothing really came out of it. It was just something to sully them, you know, make them look bad. Now this is the story that Anuj describes, and the stories actually that Anuj describes therefore have unfolded before my eyes, although in a different case. And as a practitioner, this has meant that I often advise people who seek my legal advice not to approach the court at all, or alternatively approach the high courts. Do I have a few minutes to talk about? 2-3 minutes. Okay, now, because Anup has brought up the manual scavenging case and put it in the category of the good PIL, and actually if you look at it in terms of the final judgment, which is a reported judgment, it is a good PIL, because we have a good judgment at the end. But if you look at the journey of 8 years, 9 years that we had before the court, it was really hard. And we've had several ups and downs. One of them, in fact, there was a point at which the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court actually asked us, I think around 7 years into the case, to prove the maintainability, saying that when there is a statute protecting your rights, what is the meaning of filing a writ petition under Article 32? And we had to argue this for 3 hours. So, you know, those are situations maybe I'm too close to it, but I really wouldn't describe that as being a good PIL, a good result maybe. in terms of, you know, the advice that one is forced to constantly give to clients is that don't come to the court, or at least have your homework in place before you come. Now, we've been advising people for a very long time to go to the high courts, but this remedy also is becoming increasingly unavailable. And just coming back to what you said about, you know, the facts that the way the Supreme Court behaves is flowing down to the High Court. So even at this moment, we're dealing with situations where the Shimla High Court, for instance, has issued directions after directions and threat of contempt, etc., etc., for removal of encroachments from forest areas. The fact that a large number of these encroachments are actually forest dwellers who have rights under the Forest Rights Act, that question has been put before the court. It's been put in the form of a writ petition. It's been argued. It's been put in the form of an affidavit. The central government has argued this, but the court is just ignoring it. So it's like, even in terms of how do you make them hear when they're deaf? And similarly, I think a couple of weeks ago, the Nainital High Court, in a case relating to forest fires, which all of us know Uttarakhand has huge forest fires and it's an important issue to discuss. So you're talking about forest fires and you're talking about protecting wild animals who are stuck inside these forest fires, you issue a final judgment in which there's one paragraph about removing one gujars from the forest. And suddenly there's this utter chaos in the entire state about what are we going to do? Because we were never party to this case. So this is the kind of thing that's happening. What I'm finding in my law practice is that marginalized communities are either still stuck in the 1980s letter petition time warp, or are increasingly wary of approaching the court at all. Now, for me as a practitioner, this is an unacceptable situation. We cannot simply surrender the arena of constitutional and fundamental rights because we are ill-equipped to tackle the present reality. I strongly believe that to do so would be a failure on our paths to rise to the challenge. So Anuj's book interestingly comes to me as a relief, because it shines an unrelenting light on everything that we have been doing wrong till now. And having done that provides us with an opportunity to seek out new paths through the quagmire. And that, Anuj, is another book.
Thank you very much. This panel has been completely stunning, kept to time very sweetly. Thank you. Anuj, I can't possibly follow this panel, but I have three minor curiosities. One, I was curious about, you know, just in terms of history of legal ideas, in terms of how Delhi University Law Fac was in the 80s, and there was reference to the Hingoranis and Upen's work, and there was all this stuff around law and social action, which was also shadowed by the Ford stuff, right? Law and development, law and social action kind of courses. But the distinction which Upen makes with between social action litigation, which I don't know if you take seriously, and PIL, social action litigation, this distinction doesn't really catch on, right? And it doesn't really, social action litigation doesn't enter the vocabulary of judicial populism. So I was wondering if one would map a different story, if one would take the distinction between SAL and PIL seriously, or do you think social action litigation is also part of that romance, or this this kind of part of, is a product of this romance with PIL? Talking of romance, I think you have a romance with Mark Galanta. And I was wondering whether you would critique the idea of debased informalism as one that gestures towards some form of pure or good informalism that is not mutated. And the third is related to your other work on media and films and your interest in visuality. Is whether when one does an ethnography of law, especially appellate law, does visuality and social media do something to a reading of appellate law and to the changing forms of publicity, especially if you go to the Supreme Court canteen, there's a television there, and you know, we were very struck about, you know, we checked out the channels which were being sort of viewed during last February. And so does it alter the form of PIL? The nature of publicity.
Thank you. Thank you. I have a lot to respond to, and I'm really grateful to you all for your generous criticism as well as comments, and there's a lot to think about. And obviously, I will not be able to respond in any detail or in do any justice to your comments right now, but I will try to at least address one question, at least one point that each of you raised, and you know, hopefully there'll be a longer discussion after, even outside this room, that we can continue this. Okay, so let's start vice versa. Let's start with Pratiksha, and then I'll go to the, you know, because my notes are against that way. Now, talking about SAL and PI, this is Professor Baxi's very influential formulation, and in probably the most famous thing ever written about PIL, this article called Taking Suffering Seriously. It's the, as we say in clunky legal prose, legal locus classicus on PIL. Definitely the most cited thing ever written on PIL. So you know, my point about social action litigation and public litigation, perhaps the difference, the difference is interesting, but perhaps the fundamental point is that the question really is, is it litigation at all that we're talking about? You know, I mean, my point about PIL and SAL is that it's not really any more litigation in the way that we understand litigation at all. You know, that's not the you know, this formulation is of course interesting and important. Already, firstly, I mean, my you know, what Professor Baxi tries to do is to counterpose the American variety of PIL, which has a longer history and it's a different kind of thing. With the Indian variety, which had just emerged. This article is written in 1979. There were various versions, but 81 is probably the last version. Now, but Firstly, it's a very interesting thing that, you know, when I was teaching in US and studying in US, when I say something, when I did a work on PIL, immediately my American audience will feel like they already know what PIL is, you know, because, you know, they all know PIL as well. But American PIL is a completely different thing. You know, Indian PIL is a judge-led phenomenon which happens only in appellate courts. In US, PIL is can be done at any level of, and it's mainly a lawyer-led thing. You know, it's a particular kind of good legal practice or pro bono legal practice, etc. But it's interesting how this idea of PIL as this thing that good lawyers do continues to pervade our idea of PIL. You know, I've seen even. Well, I will not take his name, but a person I cite a lot in this book, who's not Professor Baxi, who's the person I cite the most, obviously, who talked about this case, which was about organization called SIMI being banned, and some good lawyers doing some good work with regard to successfully getting the High Court to say that this ban is illegal, and this luminary called it a PIL. It has nothing to do with PIL, but that is that the American idea of PIL as good legal practice continues to influence the way we think about this object called PIL in the Indian system, quote unquote. But and it does an interesting ideological work. That American notion of PIL influences the way we think about Indian PIL, and that's a really interesting thing about how to think about law comparatively. You know, what Professor Baxi tried to counterpose as SAL versus what PIL is, which is American kind of PIL, in terms of its concerns being consumers and environment, etc., increasingly became the concern of PIL. So, you know, so what Professor Baxi tried to provide a possibility of a different trajectory for this still emerging field, but actually took, in some sense, concerns very soon, the kinds of concerns that the American PIL already had. But my primary point on this question remains that that the fundamental thing about we have to understand about PIL and or SAL for that matter is that it's not litigation at all in the way we understand it. And there's a principle. If there's one takeaway from my book, I try to emphasize is this point that our analytical tools to understand PIL in the way that we have used it so far are inadequate. It is not litigation in the way we understand it. You know, it is a completely different, you know, well, beast. Anyway, so that's the first thing I want to say. I plead guilty to a romance with Margalanta. I definitely do have a deep-seated romance with his work. And whether there's the good informalism. Now, that's an interesting segue to Professor Menon's comments. Can I just call you Nivi if you don't? Anyway, so to comments on this point, which has actually been the most substantive critique that I feel I need to respond to some extent, though I'll not be able to respond in any great detail. Now, I remember Nivi once came to the place I should study at that time, Columbia University, to present her book, to discuss her book. And I remember her saying that, the well-known formulation, the author is dead. And of course, as soon as this book was published, the author died. You know, and not because Nivi killed him, but because, you know, I mean, that's the way she read it. And it's interesting, at some level, the fact that she thinks that that this book is trying to show a kind of a belief in legal formalism and a new romance with legal formalism or whatever, kind of a retro romance, if you can call it. I think here the concern of this book is really, it's more of a labor of the negative. It's trying to argue against informalism rather than to argue for formalism. You know, it's not trying to, basically the point is the kind of ideological move that the introduction of informalism does, you know, in extremely mediated institutions like PIL, like what the Indian Supreme Court looks like. Try to, if anybody who's here is not a lawyer, try to get into Supreme Court to see a PIL. You will not be able to, firstly. So the idea that, this place with its, liveried attendants in turbans, who move the chair for the Supreme Court just to sit in, attempting to mimic some idea of popular justice or some idea of informality of in any kind is absurd beyond belief, right? I mean, that should be obvious to anybody. But obviously, what I'm trying to say is that, so it's not about necessarily celebrating this kind of formality per se. Now, my point is this, that the ideological move that accompanied it was during the emergency, really, Mrs. Gandhi's onslaught on the judiciary, on the fact of, you know, that the fact that we have an Anglo-Saxon system which did not allow access to most of the citizens, etc. I mean, led to this idea that we should have a system which will be, closer to the people at some level. There was a populist language that it tried to harness, and it did successfully to a large extent. It has, what we instead got, what we were the worst of both worlds, which are these incredibly formal institutions trying to act informally. At various levels from the emergency, during the emergency there were constitutional amendments which saw tribunals as the great solution. These new kinds of hybrid institutions which try to combine both is what got out of it. But I'm moving from the point perhaps, which is that Qadi justice. Now Qadi justice, of course, my advisor from my PhD, which is what this book is based on, was a person who worked in Islamic law, and he immediately told me, how can you use this term? This is a deeply problematic term. And I agree. I mean, it's certainly a term which has enormous amount of ideological baggage. And you could say a particular kind of orientalist, I would certainly agree with that. And this is not about, it certainly uses a concept from Islamic law in a very dubious sense. But what I was trying to use it as is a kind of ideal type, very ideal type of a certain celebration. What happens is that he presented Qadi justice here in this, 250 pages out of his Economy Society, which is on law, those 250 pages, he tried to present Qadi justice as the ideal type of, in terms of the opposite of modern law. The exact opposite of rational, formal, reasonable, formality. I'm trying really to say that while this particular term might have that history, I'm here using this idea of a modern institution in this particular moment of trying to mimic that Qadi justice, that particular formula, that particular opposite of modern law, in its attempt to bring closer to the people. Now, one might say that a lot of people read Weber as this person who believes in this this new kind of notion of modern law as something that he necessarily favors, or that he necessarily believes it's a good thing, or that that's an evolutionary schema. But I think Weber is perfectly aware of the kind of tragedy which accompanies the introduction of formal law, and in the colonial context, it's absolutely clear the tragedy which accompanied the introduction of such formal legal rationality. It's absolutely clear. But at the same time, there is no question about the fact that. And therefore, it's important here to move away from any kind of organic metaphor that the legal necessarily flows from the social in any way, which is a legacy that Durkheim's work has left us, unfortunately. That we continue to think that there is a kind of direct link between the two. But I'm sorry, I'm digressing perhaps a little bit. But all I'm trying to say is this: the history which introduced this formal rationality to a place like India is a deeply violent one. The romance for a reversion to an indigenous law, which PIL, among other things like Loka Dalits and idea of popular legality in general tries to enact, is a highly dubious one, is a highly problematic one. And that's what I'm trying to say. It's really a labor of the negative in that sense. That's what I would try to emphasize. It's not, there are enormous problems. I mean, formalism has its well-known critique, which I have enormous sympathy for. But this particular experiment combines the worst of both, is what I was trying to say. Rohit, now, the one point of yours that I want to address is this question of pathology, of how PIL represents the pathology of legal Indian legal system, considering it's less than 2% of the cases. Now, this is a point that Varun Gauri had particularly made. He'd done a lot of numerical work around this, quantitative work to document the number of PIL cases that are there. In fact, it's less than 1%. Now, the problem with that particular approach, firstly, is that in those numbers that he's looked at, the Forest case that Shomona talked about, it will be one case. Now, the Forest case is heard every Friday for the last 20 years for 2 hours. And now there are two benches, right? Two benches, so it's heard every 4 hours. So to think about that as one case, it would probably take, Forest case probably has taken more time as some jurisdictions, the entire jurisdiction might have taken, this particular one case has taken. So to look at numbers as if it represents, it can make us understand the nature of what the Supreme Court is doing is highly misleading. And the Forest case is, of course, the grandest of such cases, but there are many other cases. One of the cases I've talked about, going on for 31 years, which Deepu here has written much more about, this case which began with stone crushing units and now and had many avatars. I call it the PIL with 9 lives, we know it now as the ceiling case. But what I'm trying to say is that, so how do you call this one case, So these numbers, of course, are not very useful to understand this thing as PIL. But the point about the pathology remains. Now, I think PIL is actually, gives us a unique, to study PIL gives us a unique vantage point to understand just how deep the pathology in the legal system is. Because at some level, you see how it emerged was to create a parallel structure, a parallel jurisdiction to bypass the existing problems of civil and criminal system. So how do we look at PIL? We look at PIL as the grand and the appellate courts in general as the grand solution to India's problems, right? Any problems, you go to Supreme Court, you file a few pages petition on any issue, and the Supreme Court will solve our problems. And this is how we all look at this. Many of us do. The point is that at the same time we have this view that the lower courts, of course, are deeply pathological. This simultaneous view of one as the only institution in India which can solve any problems, the other which is like the worst of all, is an interesting kind of dichotomy that we simultaneously have in our view of the legal system. Now, so what happens instead is that instead of trying to in any way solve or trying to grapple with the deep pathologies of the civil justice and criminal system, we create these parallel institutions, lok adalats, tribunals, PIL, which actually become worse than all the existing institutions that we have. So what happens is that it started with the notion of legal aid. Let's remember that. I mean, that's how the idea of legal aid was in the mid 70s was used it was introduced as a directive principle of the 42nd Amendment by Mrs. Gandhi. Let's remember that. But PIL or lok adalat has nothing to do with legal aid. You see, it's legal aid is what? It's somebody who cannot have access to the legal system for financial reasons. You provide them, pro bono or lawyering at a reasonable cost. Instead of doing that, you create a parallel structure. You say that this existing structure is beyond, it cannot be salvaged. So you do not try to help to revive the legal aid system. Instead, you create this parallel edifice, which combines the worst of all. So all I'm trying to say is that at some level, I do think that that actually it helps us understand the pathologies pretty well. Anup, some interesting point you raised on this question of evidence. It was was interesting that maybe emphasizing evidence so much might be counterproductive in some ways, etc. Now, I agree with you that the point was that the kinds of evidence or the lack of evidence the kind of minuscule evidence which the courts relied on to demolish slums in Delhi in particular was unbelievable. I mean, they would just look at some photographs of this unsanitary looking place and they would decide that this deserves to be demolished. Now, the interesting thing in the context in which I talk about this is quite remarkable, because is actually this case that I was following up, the particular slum demolition case that we were, that I began this work with, where our friend Jawaharlal, who was arguing the case, was trying to convince Justice Mukundakam Sharma, who was heading the bench at the time, to say that he was making a factual point on the fact that these are not pakka structures. This was the point at the time that these are pakka structures. They are semi pakka, and therefore they are not slum in the definition of what. The court immediately responded, but this is a factual issue. How can we go into it? This entire case hinges only on factual issues. The petition started, the whole enterprise of demolishing these thousands of structures all over the city hinged only on factual issues. But at the same time, the court could continue to make this point that we can't go into factual issues. It's a writ court. It's a court of under 220. Constitutional court cannot go into questions of fact. So it's an interesting aspect that the court can retain that point of law, which it is spectacularly departing at the same time for to address its antagonist. So here I would just quote, I think this particular approach has been perfected by the court. This kind of simultaneous double standards, very consistently the court managed to do that. There's Pratap Mehta once said that the legitimacy and power that India's judiciary does enjoy most likely flow not from a clear and consistent constitutional vision, but rather from its opposite. That it can wear many hats, or at any point it can say, it can suddenly show indignation and take upon in any issue without looking at evidence, or it can say the opposite whenever that situation arises. On this question of good PIL, I think that these similar concerns could be raised on good PIL. I think it's an important point, and Shomona has given us a good illustration with her work on with her example of Safai Karamchari Andolan, etc. And I think it's I was actually witness of this particular hearing where somehow I was present in court at the time the Chief Justice of India, who happened to be the only Dalit Chief Justice of India that we have had, actually said that there's no such thing as manual scavenging. It's incredible that happened. That there's no manual scavenging in India. He actually said it, and how he almost wanted to dismiss the petition after so many years. So, so that also happened. This here randomness, based on nothing, based on his own sociological insights and personal sociological insights, the then Chief Justice decided that it didn't deserve to be. So that is the kind of randomness. This is one small example. Normally, it's the sociological insights of the amicus curiae, but which the court relies on. But sometimes the court decides to rely on its own insights. Now, I just on this point of the amicus curiae, I just want to. I think it's a really important thing that we need to. Do you have
2 minutes?
2 minutes. Okay, let's read this paragraph about the amicus curiae in this famous case, which is again a 30-year-old case leading to many orders, and most famously the CNG order, but the many, many, many other kinds of things. Right now they are supervising construction of expressways on western peripheral expressway as well as eastern peripheral expressway, among other things they are doing. So this case, writ petitions 13029 of 1985, also called MC Mehta case, which doesn't help us understand anything, continues to thrive in the Supreme Court with the same amicus curiae, Mr. Harish Salve, who has held this position in this PIL for 2 decades now. This means he is much more conversant with this case than any judge who hears it, because typically a Supreme Court judge would officiate in such a case for 2-3 years at the most. In the other unending mammoth PIL, popularly known as the Forest case, which is really the record-breaking PIL case in every way, in which Mr. Salve has served as amicus for a similar period, I've had a chance to witness him address and brief a new incumbent judge joining the Forest bench, so that the latter would be acquainted with the background and glorious history of the case. It's just a really some sight to see. This is a newbie judge who's sat on the bench, and Mr. Salve is briefing him, about what the great things that they've achieved in the last many years. The story of many landmark PIL cases is often written with good reason in terms of the judges heading the bench and identified with their charisma, Justice Kuldeep Singh being a good example. But perhaps the time has come to narrate the history of some other more recent PILs in terms of the charismatic amicus curiae involved in them, as they play a no less central role in steering the case in new directions. So I just wanted to flag this point. I mean, this institution of amicus curiae comes again and again in this case and in this book, and it's really an endemic problem at this stage. And there are many aspects to this that are there.
Sorry? You on auto rickshaws.
Yeah, you view an auto rickshaw. It's an amazing, as we are in Delhi, there is this, there was a long period in which the number of auto rickshaw licenses were frozen, and because of which they led to arbitrage in terms of sale of auto rickshaw licenses, meaning the cost of auto rickshaw per se is 1.2 lakhs at the time, and the cost of getting the license would be 4 lakhs to 5 lakhs extra. That was the kind of, black economy that surfaced around it. So when one of the unions, auto rickshaw unions, in 2008 tried to ask the court for increasing the number of licenses, it was frozen at 55,000 for a long time. Mr. Salve, who was the amicus in the same case, came up with his brilliant sociological insight, which is that if the number of auto rickshaws in the city increases, then it will lead to traffic jams, which will lead to a higher amount of pollution because of the fact that static traffic, will be emitting more smoke, and therefore numbers of auto rickshaws should not be increased. Obviously, number of Bentley cars and the number of diesel cars should not be should never be frozen, because those are or any cars should any private car should not be frozen. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Gautam. First of all, as someone who spent the last 4 years trying to very painfully unlearn the PIL hagiography that we were taught in college, thanks for writing this book. You said a lot that I've been burning to say for a long time, so thanks. My question is actually takes on from something that Anup said, which is how PIL, I think, has stifled development of civil rights, and I'd like your opinion on that. Two specific issues. One is that when PIL begins in the 1980s, that's, I think, when you first see this habit of laying down guidelines, which is basically an executive function, but the court begins to do that in PILs. And then you have Kartar Singh in 1994, where the court upholds Tada, but seems to think it's done its job by laying down guidelines which nobody will ever follow. So do you think that this whole idea of upholding bad civil rights laws which should be struck down, but at the same time framing guidelines which are not followed, does that come from PIL? Do you see a migration of that PIL style into civil rights cases? That's the first question. And the second is that, do you think that PIL has also stifled the development of equality jurisprudence? Because if you look at it, after the 1980s, in countries like South Africa, Canada, Colombia, and so on, you have a very substantive development of equality law and philosophy. In India, we have been static since Royapa. Is that because cases that would otherwise have come to court as substantive equality cases end up coming as PILs and then become lost in that entire morass? And is there any specific case you think could be an example of that phenomenon? Thanks.
I'm Ajay. I'm from Vidhi Center. Thank you for your book, Anuj. I think it provides some really some interesting departures from the traditional discourse of PIL. So I see between the deontological sort of arguments and the consequential argument, perhaps a space for an institutional justification. And perhaps I think that's what you are trying to hint at, that an institution being, let's say, in some way a public system of rules, it's PIL that has not allowed or that has stunted the institutional growth of the court as a public system of rules. That I think perhaps if I'm reading your book correctly, that's one insight I would draw from it. But then, if we look at PIL, would you agree that to an extent it sort of judicializes the politics, what Ron Herschel calls juristocracy, as in sort of PIL sort of is an entry door of juristocracy, and perhaps when we look at the role of court in a democracy, then how does that judicialization of politics and the juristocracy that Herschel calls it, you know, how does that relate with the institutional idea of a court? Thank you.
Rationalism, and towards the end when you responded, you said that you recognize the tragedy of colonial imposition, the way that formal legal rationalism was imposed through colonialism. But the way that it was imposed was precisely through procedure, and there has been so much work in legal anthropology on the procedure being the punishment and a variety of other things, that to pick on the relaxation of procedure as something that is a problem when the procedure itself is the problem is something that I thought was perhaps you could comment on. The second question I had was that, and which has also been raised by the panelists, was that in a sense your book suffers from a convenient sampling. So you've chosen cases which are in Delhi where the judges have an interest in pushing PILs compared to the large, perhaps a majority of cases where there is indifference even within the PIL procedure. So I think, you know, your sample is so convenient that it cannot help but make the argument, whereas in fact, there are other controls which perhaps might make a very different kind of argument.
Thanks, Anuj. Obviously, a book release is not a time to ask questions about the book, but I some parts of the book presented earlier, and sat through the discussion now. And part of my question, of course, is already preempted by Nandini, but I just want to phrase it slightly differently. It seems to me that you see the subversion of procedure or bringing in of the consequence as the justification for it, as a cause of the decline of the legal system, so that it's infected other arenas also. But perhaps it is an effect also at the same time of, so when she's saying that it is the procedure, now there can be two ways in which you can read this. One is that the strict adherence to procedure itself is a subversion of justice. But the other is that the procedure itself has already had, when necessary. This is like the way Government of India functions, or the way all other arms of the Indian state function. The Indian judiciary, I mean, what I heard Shomona say was that better not go to the court, right? Now, if you can say that of the lower courts, is these guys are going to eventually go higher. And so what happens, I think, just to cut the long story short, if you look at what happens to the PIL in terms of the procedure question, not as the cause, not as the originary moment of the decline of the judicial process, as an effect of a longer story.
By saying that this is not really litigation, well, part of the sort of discussion around what litigation in India is that it is not litigation in any sense of adversarial. It is about harassing your opponent. It is about, you know, a variety of different ways of doing things, which it is done through the courts as one instrument. So what is this litigation that you're holding it up to as an alternative? What is this procedure? What is this rational? And it's all the silences that I think are the most intriguing part of your book.
I just thought on procedure and build on that. My name's Raman. So, Anuj, you know, I'm just curious, in many other courts and legal systems, and I agree that it's very difficult to make the comparison or strictly compare them, but you see an engagement between the legislative process and procedure and jurisdiction. I was just curious, have you seen political engagement on that question from outside of the senior judiciary or the senior bar? Because what I just find, you know, striking is that even if you look at the US complicated political system, it actually came from engagement with congressional process. The Judiciary Act of the 20s cut down the US Supreme Court's docket and actually created whatever modern public interest law comes out of that framework. In human rights law in Europe, the European Court of Human Rights has had a very political, policy-driven, complicated process around jurisdiction, accepting stuff. I'm just curious, is it because we hated what Indira Gandhi did during the emergency that there's been no serious, has there been any serious political engagement or even, let's say, legislative discussion around jurisdiction and procedure to address some of these questions? So has it all been judges and the bar? Because one thing I just was struck by is that none of the High Court manuals of procedure or the Supreme Court's own rules of procedure have actually ever been looked at from ministers, at least to my knowledge. I may be wrong. I'm just curious on that.
Yeah, thanks for the, that was a very intense discussion. I have two main questions. My first one takes off from what Gautam had asked. Do you see the decline in the Supreme Court's hearing of cases by constitution benches commensurate to the increase in PILs, in the sense that most PILs are not framed as substantial questions of law, even though they might actually involve one, and then end up being heard by benches of two or three judges? That was the first question. And secondly, you pointed out how the role of the petitioner is becoming increasingly irrelevant in PIL cases, where after a certain point, the court discards the petitioner and then proceeds to go on. So what's your take on the phenomenon of the court on its own motion, right? When it takes up that particular cause title, when it takes up matters without an actual petition based on a newspaper report or even a judge driving on a road someday and then seeing something and then cases coming up from there.
Hi, my name is Raghav. I'm a practicing lawyer. I've had sort of ringside seats to many of the cases that you've been talking about. I was just wondering what your take would be on a case, for example, like 2G. Now, this is a PIL which is a good PIL in the sense that bad people, large corporates, corrupt ministers are brought to book. But in the process, what you've also done, and this brings your entire procedure issue into sharp focus, what you've done is you've taken away what we understood to be the CRPC. There was, for example, at Section 482. Now, when we went in a 482, we were told, no, the Supreme Court, in an interim order, again, going back to Anup's point on interim orders, says, if you have anything to do with this case, you please come to us directly. Now, this doesn't fit very well in a lot of, you know, what you've talked about in your book. For one thing, petitioner, incredibly important. Every day, the law was basically made up pretty much on the fly by a noted PIL lawyer, who, again, I will not name, by another individual who is a politician come lawyer, who is another noted PIL litigant. They would come in, say something, and the next day it was in an order. In the process, we lost the right to apply for bail. We lost the right to apply for exemptions from personal appearance in court. Forget 482. And in the process, when we ultimately filed a 32, came back before them, there was this utterly bizarre order saying, in cases of corruption, what is your complaint? We are giving you a chance to come directly to us, and we are the best court in the country. Now this doesn't really fit in very well, because it's an outcome many of us may find utterly palatable, achieved through a manner which has eroded what we understood to be procedural rights, which are also substantive rights. I'm sorry, I realized that wasn't really much of a question.
It's very, very good that you asked this question, and I completely agree with you, actually, because that's precisely what happens when you go to Supreme Court filing a PIL for anything. I mean, you're right, firstly, that certain litigants continue to be important. Depends on, you know, in circumstances, depending on the judge, depending on, you know, the certain, if you are Subramanu Swami or some such petitioner, you know, you have a certain access which, you know, most people in the room or forget about people, you know, the kinds of litigants that Shomona was talking about, certainly would not have that kind of access. So certainly, yeah, it's a very selective, just what, as I read Pratap Mehta's point, you know, that you have this contradictory, you know, it's not about setting a principle, it's about being, you know, having a standard which can be dispensed with whenever it's convenient, and that's what they do, you know. I think it's a really important point what you've raised, that this kind of diminution of importance given to the lower courts, to the regular process of civil procedure or criminal procedure, is a major casualty of PIL cases. You know, I mean, this is for many reasons, including the laziness of litigants or the access they have to the court, that they can just go straight away to the you know, without needing to try to file a complaint. If it's not filed, then you file the 482 and then file an appeal based on that. No, you don't need to do any of those. You go straight to Supreme Court, ask them to appoint an SIT or an SCBI, and you know, and then whatever they offer, you just so yeah. I mean, absolutely, it's become one of those situations where justice has to come right from the top or none at all. So I agree with you. This is a serious casualty, I think, I don't think it in any way contradicts actually what I'm saying. In fact, it's precisely what is happening there. I think the most substantive, important critical points have been raised by Nandini, so I will just come straight to hers. I have to find it, one sec. Yeah. Now, yes, definitely procedure is the punishment largely in regular legal process in India, absolutely. I mean, let's just accept as almost axiomatic, absolutely. But with all its problems, it offers you that fig leaf. You know, it offers you a certain, you know, if you just to harass the other party is, of course, a regular practice in this country. So so it's not like I think that the what I'm trying to say is this highly flawed non-working civil and criminal justice system was given up on entirely by this movement in the mid 70s when they adopted these parallel systems. Instead of trying to do something with it, in any way, what happened instead was that there was no attempt to try to reform it. In fact, when they attempt to reform it also, this is a work documented by a young scholar called Bradish Ranjan, on civil, in CPC, when they tried, in civil procedure, when they tried to introduce reforms, putting time limits on filing replies or notices, the court has actually discarded it. The court actually said that those are not binding on them. You see, so that kind of idea that even when attempt is made to reform them, the court is not interested in it. You see, and that doesn't have the kind of flamboyant it doesn't have the kind of flamboyant appeal that PIL cases etc. have. But I agree with you. I mean, certainly there's no need to romance the rest of the legal system just to attack PIL. I agree. I mean, definitely there's plenty wrong with that. But they need to salvage that in some way. They need to protect that. See, all of these procedural protections are not like, I mean, they are rights. You know, they have to be thought of as rights rather than as problems to be overcome alone. This things like I talk about necessary and proper parties, in the cases like she's talking about, the one good judge being ordered to be evicted without them being part of the case at all. And this is absolutely the most common thing that happens in many cases, as you know, in many of these PIL cases. Now, this is a simple principle of civil procedure, that if you are affected by a litigation, you have to be party to it. But that is no longer considered an absolutely almost sacred principle of litigation. But that is not something that the court thinks is important anymore. Now, convenient sampling is an important point. To this, actually, I would like to read a little quote. You're right that certainly I choose cases which are in that sense useful to illustrate my point. So I will just try to say this. In the previous chapters, this is towards the end of the book, while I've drawn attention to the disastrous outcomes of certain PIL cases, my emphasis has been on how such outcomes result from the inherent unfairness of PIL procedure. The objection, however, may be that one can easily conceive good outcomes also resulting from a process of adjudication which is similarly unjust. Consider the typical suo motu PIL, the kind of court on its own motion kind of phenomenon, where a court takes up a policy issue, appoints its favorite lawyer as amicus curiae, suggests solutions based on half-baked evidence collected by its own random appointees, issues legislative guidelines binding as law, and then appoints personnel to monitor the implementation of these guidelines. This rather familiar PIL process, so unremarkable right now as to seem like the contemporary norm, can certainly result in good outcomes, and it sometimes does. So enduring is Justice Bhagwati's criterion for PIL's evaluation, that any criticism of PIL per se is constantly confronted by the question, what about these good PILs, which have successfully offered such grand solutions to the country's problems? The analysts of PIL then reach for their Benthamite hedonistic calculus, measuring the pain of the people who have suffered from PIL against the pleasure of those who have gained from it. And after careful calculation, they declare that the despotism of PIL judges is still acceptable because it is on balance benevolent. My aim here is to move the debate on PIL away from an analysis based on such a facile calculus. The problem with PIL is not just that it increasingly leads to unjust outcomes because of the changed ideological climate, but that it can so easily do so because of its diminution of judicial process. My attempt here is to formulate an anti-PIL critique aimed at moving this critique away from outcomes to process. So obviously, it's a I don't know whether this is adequate response to. I think maybe it's not. I'm not adequately responded to your point still, though. Certainly there's this convenience. I mean, there are many other examples you could give. And your point actually was more about the fact that the courts are interested in these issues and they're not interested in many other issues. Mm-hmm. That they don't entertain issues which are. Yeah. Yeah, that's true. I mean, you see, I'm just trying to say that that same point again, the Pratap Mehta point that you know that it can keep these principles and it can depart from them conveniently whenever they want. I mean, you know, there are cases which it dismisses, which is not interested in. And you see, I'm just trying to say that you're right that this is a case of excessive judicial interest in a place like Delhi and its urban governance, and that there are many instances where it's not interested. I don't know, I'm still getting a point entirely, but there's another point of yours which I want to also combine with this, which is the last point of litigation. What is this contrary litigation that you're contrasting it to? Right, that's true, that what is this contrary, but you know, I would try to say this, that it's true again, I mean, the same point as I made about the civil and criminal system, that it has its, I mean, it is really pathological. There's no other word for the way the rest of the legal system is proceeding. But at the same time, and the procedure is the punishment, but you see, the introduction of informality actually makes it the worst of all worlds. You see, it's this romance for, unelected authority that we this PIL is an example. Anyway, I don't think I'm getting addressing a point still, which is that this other litigation. You're right, probably it's a mirage. It doesn't exist, at least in this country. That there isn't any other proper litigation, which is. But I think even in those highly flawed criminal cases, there is a process. There's an attempt there is at least a representation. There is an attempt to go through the through the regular process, which to some extent at least does not relate to the kind of example I gave of this kind of where the court can just do anything from initiating the case to ending it from its vantage point. But I think it's a longer conversation which we have to continue. But I don't think I'm still doing justice to your comment. But I've tried. Let's see. We'll continue this conversation. Now Gautam's point. On the guidelines, definitely. I mean, one of the earliest critics of PIL. In fact, I think some of the best writings on PIL were written in the early 80s, because at the time it was still new, and it had still not become commonsensical as it has to us. It no longer surprises us the kind of absurdities of PIL anymore, which it did in the early 80s. Justice Hidayatullah wrote this article in 1984, Highways and Bylanes of Justice, where he made fun of these guidelines. He compared it to this mode of functioning of PIL, the Jahangir's Janziri Adl, the gold chain outside his the golden bell outside his house. Anyway, but this guideline formulation is particularly, I mean, the examples you give are pertinent, and especially the AFSPA example, the Armed Forces Special Powers Act example is a particularly good one. And I think this mode, and it again did it in the PUCL case with regard to encountered killings. It was again a highly egregious example of this kind of practice where instead of striking down AFSPA, it tries to create some kind of conveniently bona fide idea of what the army would do to practice AFSPA in the right way. This particularly convenient idea that it works with is an example. But again, it's a point that I'm trying to address briefly in the first chapter, in the context of the PUCL case. But I don't think I'm again addressing a point adequately. Substantive equality, and this is an important point again, I think this recourse, the easy recourse to PIL has, simply because it's relatively easy, you just have to file a petition as opposed to go through, exhaustion of other remedies before you reach there, is something that one has to think about, because of the fact of the costs involved, the fact that at any point you can be removed from the case as happens, very often. And partly, of course, it's related to the fact that 21 has become this 21 has become this receptacle for everything, and you don't have to argue on any other fundamental rights anymore. You know, everything is 21, which basically means everything is 21 except the literal wording of 21, which is that you know, no person shall be deprived of life or personal liberty except procedure established. But that is not 21. TADA, as by everything, is not in a validity of 21, but you know, all kinds of other things are. So so I mean, there is a cost, and I think. It's something to, you know, again, there's a longer response is needed to all of this. I'm not going to be able to do justice to so many of the other things that have been said. Is there anything in particular which I should try to, I mean, there's so many things, but Aditya's point on procedure. Anyway, I mean, hopefully we can continue this conversation. There's a lot more to be said, but, you know, I think as long as, you know, as long as this makes you, sorry?
Yes.
By the book. Exactly, most importantly. And think critically about what I'm trying to say. I look forward to all the big bats and everything else. Thank you.
Thank you.